New discoveries from JWST and Euclid have revealed a jumbo mystery for modern astronomy. It's an enigma that defies our theories of planet and star formation, and may even make our dreams of going interstellar a little bit easier. Today, we're exploring the puzzling discovery of free-floating worlds with no star to call home, rogue planets that appear to be everywhere. The possibility of rogue planets has been with us for a while. Planetary systems are busy, chaotic places, especially in their early years, so it makes sense that planets could sometimes get ejected into interstellar space. When we first discovered the interstellar asteroid Oumuamua flying through the solar system, this proved to us that mass does sometimes get ejected, although this is certainly way below the planetary mass scale, of course. But even before that, David Nesvorny and colleagues had proposed that the solar system once had a fifth giant planet that got ejected billions of years ago, a sacrifice which makes it much easier to explain our simulations of this primordial epoch. In the field of exoplanets, evidence for rogue worlds has been accumulating for many years now. For example, the first low-mass and unbound object, called OTS-44, was discovered in 1998 through infrared measurements of a star-forming region in the constellation Chameleon. It's very tricky to estimate the mass if it's isolated like this, because there is no gravitational companion whose motion we could use to weigh the object. Instead, we know the age of this region is about 10 million years old, and so we compare this to theoretical models of how we expect the brightness and temperature of massive objects to gradually cool over time. This lets us weigh the object to be about 11 Jupiter masses. Now, that is way below the lightest star allowed by physics, about 80 Jupiter masses. But even so, should we really be calling this a planet? There's a kind of purgatory between stars and planets called brown dwarfs, usually defined as things too light to fuse hydrogen, like the sun, but should be able to fuse a bit of deuterium in their youth, where deuterium is just an isotope of hydrogen. In theory, anything heavier than about 13 Jupiter masses satisfies this criteria, and so by this definition, OTS-44 is not a brown dwarf either. It really does look like a massive planet, just bizarrely hanging out in the depths of space all by itself. Since then, many more objects like this have been found by simply taking detailed photos of young star-forming regions. Places where we expect these young rogue planets to still be hot enough from their violent formation that they still visibly glow. The best way to do this is not to use visible light like RIC, but instead use infrared light. Any warm object emits light at all wavelengths of light, even radio and X-rays, where here I'm showing the emission of an idealized black body. It turns out that the dominant wavelength at which objects emit is governed solely by their temperature. So, a hot object like the sun, with a surface of 5800 Kelvin, has a peak emission around that of visible light, 500 nanometers. In contrast, a cool object like your body has a peak emission of more like 9000 nanometers, which firmly puts it in the infrared part of the spectrum. So, aim an infrared telescope at a young star-forming region and you have the perfect recipe to search for young rogue planets. Enter JWST, an infrared telescope ideally suited for this task. Before I discuss what was found, it's usually about this point that a Google ad starts playing in your video, right? Well, it doesn't have to. Now, full disclosure, if you subscribe through the link in this post or the banner appearing on this video, I may get a commission. This video is supported by YouTube Premium. Now, you've probably heard of YouTube Premium before, but let me just tell you that it is hands down the best streaming service that I personally pay for. It means no ads before or after the video, and no interruptions during the video either. I'm listening to YouTube on my phone all the time, when running or doing jobs around the house, and with Premium, you can lock your phone, stick it in your pocket, and just keep things playing. When I can't sleep, I'll often listen to sleep aid videos on YouTube, and that is definitely a case where you do not want ads interrupting your video. Another feature I love is downloading videos on my phone ahead of long flights, so I can catch up on my favorite content without having to pay the outrageous plane Wi-Fi fees. I can't imagine going back to YouTube with ads again now. It really is the best streaming service out there, with all of your favorite content creators, like Cool Worlds, in one magical place. So I'm proud to say YouTube have partnered with me to give you 2 months of premium for free. Just use the link down below in the description to get started. You really want to snap up this deal. YouTube is amazing and I am thrilled to be supporting this campaign. Once again, the link is down below in the description, and when you use that link, it supports us too. Now back to the video. All right, so it really does look like JWST is the perfect telescope to hunt for young rogue planets, and that's exactly what Dutch astronomers Mark McCorcran and Sam Pearson recently did. Just feast your eyes on their gorgeous images of the Orion Nebula, in particular a young region known as the Trapezium Cluster. To identify planets, the team looked at the spectrum of light coming off each source spotted by JWST. Some of them look just like the idealized blackbody curve I showed you earlier, which is fairly typical of stars in fact. But many deviate, showing absorption features characteristic of molecules and cloud layers in their atmospheres. This is the dead giveaway that you are not looking at a star, for those objects are simply too hot to allow for such complex chemistry. Using this method, the team identified a whopping 540 planet candidates, which they define as planets with best fitting masses below 13 Jupiter masses. That's the canonical brown dwarf limit. There are two reasons why this is blowing the minds of the astronomy community. First, some of them are tiny, just two Saturn masses, and second, 9% of them come in pairs or even in triples. Let's take the binary thing first. So these are Jupiter mass binary objects, or jumbos as the team playfully dubbed them. But how the deuce did those form? Well, we know that binary stars are certainly very common. For stars more massive than our sun, it's actually kind of weird not to find them in a binary system. For sun-like stars though, the binary fraction drops to around 60%, and as we slide down in mass, that fraction keeps falling. By the time you get to the smallest stars, it's around 20%, and it plummets all the way down to 8% for the lightest brown dwarfs. So based on this, our expectation was that the binary fraction for rogue planets should be nearly zero, yet here it's coming out at a respectable 9%. Now, a caveat with all of this is that JWST, as powerful as it is, cannot resolve binaries which are too close together. The resolving power of the telescope here equates to about 25 astronomical units, that's close to Uranus's orbital separation around the Sun. So these jumbos could be just the tip of the iceberg, merely the widest separated examples, and many of those apparently isolated planets could in fact be very compact binaries whose separation we just can't resolve yet. Plotting the binary fraction again, but now just for the widely separated cases, we see this startling turnover at around 30 Jupiter masses. That turnover is critical and profound. It's telling us that something is different about the way these binaries formed versus stars. They are not part of some smooth continuum, but represent a distinct population. Before these results came out, I think most of us assumed that rogue planets like this could occasionally form the same way that stars do, just from giant clouds of interstellar gas collapsing under gravity. But can this process really extend all the way down to just a couple of Saturn masses like the objects that JWST sees evidence for? Theory says no. The smallest masses formed in 3D simulations this way are about 7 to 10 Jupiter masses, an order of magnitude discrepancy. There's just not enough gravitational mass to form a Saturn or even a Jupiter this way. If they don't form like stars, then perhaps they form like planets. Indeed, perhaps they were not always rogue planets, but were ejected from their home system. After all, that's an idea we've seen was already proposed for our own solar system. This seems like our best guess, but it comes with a couple of headaches. Remember that many of these objects are found in binaries, and although we have no problem imagining how a single planet could get ejected, ejecting a pair of planets from a system that then sustain their binarity is really difficult to imagine. Now, theorists are diving into this problem since the result came out. In one recent paper by Wang et al, they suggest that a stellar flyby could rip off a pair of Jupiters and form a jumbo if the two planets happen to be closely aligned during the encounter. In another paper coming out of Leiden, they suggest that ejections just don't work, and you really do need to form them in pairs to begin with, so the jury is still out on this one. To me, this puzzle has been exacerbated by a result from just a couple of weeks ago by the newly commissioned Euclid Space Telescope. Pointing again at the nearby Sigma Orionis cluster, the team have catalogued rogue planets and have measured the distribution of their frequency versus mass. We call this diagram the initial mass function, or IMF in astronomy, and it is one of the most important plots that we make. If we believe our simulations of how gas clouds collapse, then generally we expect big stuff to be rare, but the smaller the star, the easier and more common they should become. This indeed matches everything we know about stars. For example, 3/4 of all stars in the universe are M-type red dwarfs, much smaller than our sun. But this shouldn't go on forever. Eventually, the simulations predict that there's simply not enough gravitational mass to keep forming things this way. So, as noted earlier, we expect this process to become rather inefficient below about 7 to 10 Jupiter masses. And yet, staggeringly, Euclid finds that it just keeps going. More and more things form the smaller you go, with the current limit down to 3 to 4 Jupiter masses. It really does look like turtles all the way down. Now, the JWST team didn't make an IMF like this, but remember, they find objects down to even smaller masses, just 0.6 Jupiter masses. This is, again, very weird and difficult to understand. I took a look at the Euclid IMF myself, and it predicts that there is more than one substellar object for every two stars, but that is just down to the 3 to 4 Jupiter mass limit. If this extends all the way down to, say, a Neptune mass, then there would in fact be just as many rogue planets as there are stars, perhaps even more. For me, this raises two interesting issues. First, it is possible then that there is an interstellar rogue planet closer to us than Proxima Centauri. This would be a mature object that's drifting between the stars, and it could be our closest destination for a mission one day. Such worlds could even have habitable moons supported by tidal heating just like Europa. The second issue is just where is all this stuff coming from? If it is all being ejected out of solar systems, then that is a lot of ejected giant planets. As I said earlier, you'd require at least one giant planet to be ejected for every two stars for this to make sense. The problem with that is that stars don't seem to have giant planets that often. Exoplanet surveys of mature systems find that less than 1 in 5 have them. The obvious resolution to this would be that these mature systems did once have giant planets in their past, but somehow lost them through ejections. And to be fair, there is some circumstantial evidence for this. When we take photos of young planetary systems, we seem to find way more giant planets. Indeed, a recent article by Gratanow found that 2/3 of a sample of young stars appear to have giant planets. It may very well be then that we are surrounded by an ocean of rogue worlds, perhaps some forming in isolation, but many being orphans, ejected from their home at a young age. As they drift amongst the heavens, they would cool into darkness, but perhaps they retain systems of moons or orbit a binary companion. What's really exciting here is that we're just scratching the surface. What a thrilling time to be asking these questions when so much remains unknown. It is a somber reminder that we should all stay thoughtful and stay curious. Thank you so much for watching, everybody. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, be sure to hit that subscribe button. It really does help us out. And if you want to get that extra mark, you can become a supporter to my research team, the Cool Worlds Lab, just like our latest supporter, that is Paul Borisov. Thank you so much for your support, Paul. The link to support us is up here and down below in the description, so check that out too. Thanks again.